Our words for reflection this morning are titled A Violinist in the Metro, A Social and Philosophical Experiment by David Emery. A man sat at a metro station in Washington, D.C. and started to play the violin. It was a cold January morning. He played six Bach pieces for about 45 minutes. During that time, since it was rush hour, it was calculated that thousands of people went through the station, most of them on their way to work. 3 minutes went by, and a middle-aged man noticed that there was a musician playing. He slowed his pace and stopped for a few seconds, and then hurried up to meet his schedule. A minute later, the violinist received his first dollar tip. A woman threw the money in the till and, without stopping, continued to walk. A few minutes later, someone leaned against the wall to listen to him, but the man looked at his watch and started to walk again. Clearly, he was late for work. The one who paid the most attention was a three-year-old boy. His mother tagged him along, hurried, but the kid stopped to look at the violinist. Finally, the mother pushed hard, and the child continued to walk, turning his head all the time. This action was repeated by several other children. All the parents, without exception, forced them to move on. In the 45 minutes the musician played, only six people stopped and stayed for a while. About 20 gave him money, but continued to walk their normal pace. He collected $32. When he finished playing and silence took over, no one noticed it. No one applauded, nor was there any recognition. No one knew this, but the violinist was Joshua Bell, one of the best musicians in the world. He played one of the most intricate pieces ever written with a violin worth $3.5 million. 2 days later, two days before his playing in the subway, Joshua Bell sold out a theater in Boston. The seats averaged $100 each. This is a real story. Joshua Bell playing incognito in the metro station was organized by the Washington Post as part of a social experiment about perception, taste, and the priorities of people. The outlines were in a commonplace environment at an inappropriate hour. Do we perceive beauty? Do we stop to appreciate it? Do we recognize the talent in an unexpected context? One of the possible conclusions from this experiment could be that if we do not have a moment to stop and listen to one of the best musicians in the world playing the best music ever written, how many other things are we missing?
One of the first things that I do when I get a new cell phone is turn off 90% of the notifications. There are so many things that these little computers in our pocket can tell us, and there are really only a few that I want to know in real time. But every so often, some app on my phone seems to just decide that I need its notifications. Recently, it's Apple News that has made this decision for me. Maybe twice a month, some story from Apple News will pop up on my phone, and it's always something very random. It's not major headlines like you would expect. Some algorithm somewhere that Apple has decided on has determined that this would be a piece of news that I should be interested in. Not a particularly accurate algorithm, if you ask me. It happens infrequently enough that I haven't taken the time to actually find the app and its settings and turn off these seemingly random notifications. But each time one pops up on the screen, I feel a hint of annoyance. Who are you, Apple News, to decide what I want to pay attention to? The reality of our world is that there are ways in which big corporations often do get to decide what we pay attention to. Or, to put it more generally, The people in power get to decide. It's the people in power who get to decide what the dominant narrative is, what stories get told more than others, which voices get highlighted in our news and our history books. You see this so clearly in those words for reflection we just heard. The attention given to violinist Joshua Bell is directly related to his perceived status in the world. When people know that he's a world-famous violinist, they give him their rapt attention for a couple of hours and pay good money for it. When he's perceived as a street musician, people don't give their attention for more than a moment. There are places they have to be, things they need to do that are more important than listening to an anonymous street performer. In each case, the art that Bell is producing is actually less important than the story that people have in their minds about who he is and whether or not he matters. The amount of attention we give to something or someone always comes down to this question of mattering. What matters enough for us to pause and listen? Who is important enough for us to listen to their story? Our mainstream American culture would give one answer to these questions, and that answer is defined by fame and fortune. Who is important enough for us to pay attention to? People with money, with influence, with power. And perhaps even more than that, people whose identities give them power and privilege. Mainstream American culture likes to listen to wealthy, educated, gray-haired, cisgender men. And I could probably add a few more adjectives to that list. Our Unitarian Universalist faith, however, gives a very different answer to the question of who is important enough to pay attention to. In the simplest terms, our answer is everyone. Our first principle says that we affirm and promote the inherent worth and dignity of every person. The kids' version of that principle puts it even more clearly. Every person is important. As Unitarian Universalists, we believe that everyone is worth listening to, worth paying attention to. Like so many of our principles, this is an easy one to say and a hard one to live out. Especially in this era of information overload, we literally can't pay attention to everything and everyone equally. And when we say everyone's voice is important, what do we do when those voices disagree? And they do disagree. You only had to listen to about 5 minutes of this week's impeachment hearings to hear two or more very different opinions about the events that led to those hearings. There are a lot of perspectives out there in our world. There are a lot of different stories we could listen to about how we got to where we are today, about what our problems are as a culture and how we should go about fixing them. And one of the mistakes that Unitarian Universalists often make is to think that our diversity of belief means that all perspectives should be given equal weight, that all views on this world are equally valid. I don't believe that this is what our faith asks of us. And in fact, falling into this trap of moral relativism is dangerous, not only for our faith, but for our world. Freedom is not the be-all, end-all of Unitarian Universalism. Our faith is not neutral about who we pay attention to, whose voices we privilege. If you look at our other 6 principles, you can see a call to justice and equity, an acknowledgement of our interdependence. When we are asking ourselves, who do I pay attention to? I believe there are two criteria we can use: power and impact. As Unitarian Universalists, we are called to lift up the voices of those who have been oppressed and marginalized, those who historically and presently have not and do not have power in our society. We are called to listen, to be in solidarity, to follow the lead of those who have been silenced for far too long. We also need to pay attention to who is impacted the most and to trust those from impacted communities. It doesn't make much sense, for example, to ask me, an able-bodied person, about how best to accommodate people with disabilities in our midst. And I can tell you a lot about what it is like to be a woman in ministry, but I am not an expert when it comes to being a person of color in our faith. Embodying this, being mindful of power and impact when we are choosing who and what to pay attention to, is something we are still growing into as a faith. It is the opposite in so many ways of what mainstream American culture has taught us to do. And so we have to train ourselves out of what has been trained into many of us since birth. But there is a shift happening, even in more mainstream culture. I see this in some of the changing narratives about the history of our country. We're in a period of time right now that is bookended by two holidays that valorize the European colonization of the Americas: Columbus Day and Thanksgiving. Until very recently, when we spoke about these holidays, we paid attention only to one side of the story. We talked about how Columbus discovered America, how the pilgrims went through so much hardship to get to this new world and build a new life for themselves. There is a reason that these are the narratives that have predominated. They are a part of the mythos of our country, the vision of the land of the free and the home of the brave, the promised land flowing with milk and honey. They also carry the perspective of the people who wrote our history books. When history is written by white men, it is going to be the stories of white men that are told above all others. And it's going to be the perspectives of white men that are privileged. In recent years, we have begun to hear alternative narratives of both Columbus Day and Thanksgiving as the stories of the indigenous people who lived and still live on this land have become part of our common understanding. As we've begun to pay attention to those with less power, those directly impacted, the stories of the beginning of our country have changed. Christopher Columbus, for example, did not discover America. There were literally whole civilizations of people living here. He came to this land bringing violence and disease and claimed what wasn't his to claim, taking it from people who didn't even understand what he was doing at the time. And that mythical first Thanksgiving wasn't a picture-perfect cross-cultural experience of hospitality and generosity with pilgrims and Native Americans sitting down for turkey and stuffing. This wasn't a new world free for the taking. It was somebody else's world already. The arrival of the pilgrims was a takeover, sometimes violent and sometimes less so. A seizing of land and control and power. I'm grateful that in the last 20 years or so, our conversations about these days have become more nuanced. Many states have begun to adopt Indigenous Peoples Day as an alternative to Columbus Day, to lift up the stories of the people who were here long before Columbus. And some have started to refer to Thanksgiving as Thanksgiving. acknowledging the mixed feelings that many Native Americans have about this holiday. We are beginning, both as a faith and as a country, to pay attention to power and impact, to acknowledge and, on our good days, to lift up the voices that have gone unheard. And there is so much more for us to do. Sometimes it feels like for every step we take forward in this work, we take another two steps back. I know that there are people in our country and in Unitarian Universalism who are threatened by the idea that we might privilege some perspectives over others. I see this especially from those who have traditionally held power, who have traditionally had their voices privileged. There is a clinging at times, a desire to hold on to power rather than to share it with others. I feel it in myself sometimes, in a voice that says, "What about me?" Or in a reluctance to engage in anything that might make me feel uncomfortable. At the same time, I know that this work of paying attention, of changing and challenging the dominant narratives in our society, is work we are called to by the core principles of our faith. Principles that are easy to say, but not so easy to live out. We are called by our faith to pay attention. We are called by our belief in the inherent worth and dignity of every person. We are called to pay attention by our belief that our liberation is all bound up with the liberation of every other person. We are called to pay attention by lifting up the voices, the stories of the marginalized, of those most impacted. And we are called even into that discomfort that can come when we do pay attention. Because, as we heard in the story of the cricket and the coins, it's not just a matter of listening. It's a matter of what you are listening for. May we listen well.